In this video lecture, we're going to talk about two techniques we can use to ensure the integrity and correctness of instance data: mutator data checking and safe object data transfer. Okay, let's get started. One useful technique we can use to ensure the correctness of our instance variable data when building up our person class is to implement mutator data checking. We can add logic and checks to our mutator methods to make sure our instance variables are only being set to valid inbounds values, which enforces data integrity. If we try to set an instance variable to some improper value, we can reject the change and notify the user, or take whatever other action might be appropriate. So let's see how we might do this in our person class. Here at the top, we see that we've set up some private constants near the head of the class to define min and max allowable values for the height and weight. For example, we're specifying that the height must be limited from 0 to 3 meters and the weight from 0 to 400 kilograms. While these still might seem to be hefty ranges, there really have been people 8 plus feet in height and weighing more than 1,000 pounds, and so we can adjust these limits as needed. This next code snippet shows mutator data checking applied to the biological gender. Let's say we want to enforce these two possible uppercase values. We start by converting whatever character is input to uppercase, like so. Then as long as the char is equal to this value or this value, we update the instance variable as directed. But if this check fails, we then alert the user and make no change, leaving the gender instance variable unchanged. In this next code snippet, we're checking that the input height is within our allowable range, greater than or equal to the minimum value and less than or equal to the maximum value. If the input height satisfies that range, we update the height instance variable like so. But if the update value is out of range, we again alert the user and leave the current height value unchanged. In this last code snippet, we perform a comparable check on the input weight. We're testing that the value is within our certain specified range. If it is, we update the weight instance variable like so. But once again, if the update value is out of range, we alert the user and leave the current weight value unchanged. Using mutator data checking like this can help ensure that our instance variables always have proper and reasonable values. You can find all these next refinements to our person class as the person phase9.java snapshot, along with the associated code walkthrough which goes over them, which I encourage you to view after concluding this lecture video. Now, the only caveat with mutator data checking is that we have to use it for it to do us any good. More specifically, we need to use it exclusively within our full and alternate constructors to initialize our instance variables. Otherwise, we could wind up creating new objects with impermissible instance variable values. Here are some examples as applied to our person class. This first example is that of our default constructor. Here, there are no external inputs. We simply hardwire our instance variables to some specific default values internally, so there is no issue here. But in this second example, we could be trying to initialize our object with some bad values for gender, height, and/or weight. So here, rather than setting our instance variables directly to the specified inputs, we've replaced those lines with calls to the various mutator methods. Now we're intercepting any possible bad values with our mutator data checks. However, if we do have any bad values, we still need some default values to fall back to, and so that's why we have this call to this as our first statement. This statement is simply a call to the default constructor, which first initializes all the instance variables to the above sensible default values. Now we have starting values in place for all the instance variables, such that if any of the full constructor inputs are invalid, their mutator will still have some value to fall back upon. The same idea is at work in this third example, although if you recall, the leading this statement was already in place. So here, we've just replaced our former instance variable assignment statements with their respective mutator calls to take advantage of the underlying mutator data checking. Now, in this case, strings are just strings, and maybe this is overkill in this particular case, but maybe at some point in the future, we might want to check things like leading capitals for our first and last names. So it's just a good and harmless practice to use mutator calls here as well. You can find all these next refinements to our person class as the person phase9.java snapshot, along with the associated code walkthrough which goes over them, which I encourage you to view after concluding this lecture video. As we've said previously, when we add some new functionality to our class, In tandem, we should also add some new test code to our main test driver, which checks those changes. So in this example on the right, we'll use our updated mutators to try and set these instance variables to some invalid values. X for the gender, 5 meters in height, and 1,000 kilograms in weight. We'll also try to get these same invalid values set using our full constructor. In all cases, we expect some error message to be displayed and the change rejected, falling back instead to whatever is the current value. And that's what we see in the sample output. Here are the error messages from trying to update the gender, height, and weight. And here are the same 3 error messages from trying to use those 3 same bad values in our full constructor. When all is said and done, here's the resulting state of our person object. And we can see that the gender, height, and weight are unchanged from their current default values, which is exactly what we wanted to have happen if provided any bad instance variable values. You can find all these next refinements to our person class as the personphase9.java snapshot, along with the associated code walkthrough which goes over them, which I encourage you to view after concluding this lecture video. As a prelude to the next type of data safety we'll consider, consider the following example. Let's say that we set up a default person object, assuming our person class as of the person phase 8 snapshot. We also define the CS12 date object and the string object. Then let's say we use these mutators to update both the birth date and first name instance variables using these outside objects. We print the person object and we see the first name and the birth date are as we expect them to be. Then let's say that in this outside client code, we change both the date and the name external to the person object. But if we print the person object again, we see that the CS12 date birthday instance variable has been corrupted without our knowledge or okay. This is supposed to be a private instance variable, and yet it's been changed out from under us outside the class, which violates encapsulation. What the heck? And also, why is the first name string not affected by this? To look under the hood and see this code execute, please take a moment now to pause this video and view the short code walkthrough for PersonDataCorruption.java, which you'll find in the usual place. Open up this file in JGrasp so you can follow along, then come back to this video when you are finished. The problem in the previous example arises if we simply equate our instance variable birthdate object, this.birthdate, to some outside date object, as we do here in the current Person Phase 8 version of our birthdate mutator. When we do this, we are making a direct connection between what is supposed to be a private instance variable to some object in the outside world, as we see here. If the outside object changes, then so too does the internal instance variable, which is referenced to it. This is not the way to go about things. Instead, what we really need to do is to transfer the data, integer by integer, from the passed in object reference safely into our private local instance variable, as we see here, and as we'll find in the Person Phase 9 snapshot version. Here, birthdate is the input to our mutator, and it's a CS12 date object. First, we use its individual accessors to retrieve the int month, day, and year. Then we use the corresponding mutators of our instance variable object, this.birthdate, to safely transfer over each of those int values into our private instance variable. By doing this, we have safely made copies of all the input data, and the private encapsulation of our instance variable is maintained. Here's the code example of how to implement the previous diagram, how to safely pass objects into class methods. First of all, this commented out code shows how not to implement a mutator for an instance variable, which itself is some type of object. We don't simply set this.birthdate to the input object. Instead, we transfer the data of the input object over, field by field, into the instance variable object using accessors and mutators. As shown down here, we use accessors applied to the input object birthdate to retrieve its data, then we use mutators applied to the instance variable birthdate to transfer over all the data. And by the way, here, the accessors and mutators are those of the CS12 date class. You can find all these next refinements to our person class as the personphase9.java snapshot, along with the associated code walkthrough which goes over them, which I encourage you to view after concluding this lecture video. If we were to rerun the prior persondatacorruption.java example, this is the updated output we'd get. As you can see, Changing the birth date externally still leaves the birth date instance variable unchanged. By the way, none of this is an issue for the string instance variables, because according to their Java API, strings are immutable. In other words, strings can't be changed after they are created without creating new strings. So none of this applies to string instance variables, and we can leave our first name and last name mutators as is in their simple form. Finally, the opposite situation can be equally problematic, that is, returning instance variable objects from class methods such as accessors. Once again, what we don't want to do in such an accessor is to simply return the instance variable birthdate directly, such as in this commented out code. By doing this, we'd simply be giving the outside world a direct connection to our private instance variable via an object reference. Instead, a similar solution applies here. First, we create this internal throwaway CS12 date object temp, then we transfer all of the date information into it using the CS12 date accessors and mutators in the same way as before. The only thing that might be a little confusing here is this multiple dot notation, but in each case, we're simply applying one accessor to the birthdate instance variable, this.birthdate, then using the resulting int value to update our throwaway copy using its mutators. Once all is said and done, we can safely return this throwaway copy to the outside caller, and we don't care what is done to it, because the instance variable data remains safely protected. You can find all these last refinements to our person class as the person phase 9.java snapshot, along with the associated code walkthrough which goes over them, which I encourage you to view at this point. Also, take a look at the test code which shows how to demonstrate these changes are working properly. Okay, so summing up, this is how you can safely update and return instance variables, which are themselves objects, and this is what you will need to do on the next updates to the class which you'll be creating.